Those parents that brought their children, if you can make sure that they are beside you, and those kids that brought their parents, can you please make sure they're also beside you as well, please? Sallu ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad, please. A'udhu billahi minash shaytanir rajim. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. الحمد لله الذي لا يبلغ مدحته القائلون ولا يحصي نعماءه العادون ولا يؤدي حقه المجتحدون الذي لا يدركه بعد الحمم ولا يناله غوص الفطن ثم الصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين حبيب قلوبنا وطبيب نفوسنا وشفيع ذنوبنا سيدنا ومولانا أبي القاسم محمد. وأهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين المظلومين لا سيما بقية الله في الأرضين صاحب العصر والزمان خليفة الرحمن إمام الإنس والجان ولعن الله أعداهم أجمعين إلى يوم الدين أما بعد فقد قال الله وقوله الحق بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم إن تبتوا صدقات فنعم هي وإن تخفوها وتعتوها فقراء فهو خير لكم ويكفر عنكم من سيئاتكم والله بما تعملون خبير صدق الله العلي العظيم. We are thankful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for the continued tawfiq and blessing to be His guest in this beautiful month of Ramadan. Alhamdulillah, it is a blessing and a sharaf and an honor of mine to address this beloved community for the next 5 nights. My last lecture is on Saturday when we commemorate the wafat, inshallah. The flyer that's been floating around, the topic that my lectures will have is on that flyer. We will be discussing the concept of being anonymous in these next 5 nights. And I'll explain what I mean by that tonight in my half an hour discussion. But first, let's understand a little bit of the duality that we live in. We live in a very extreme dichotomy today. And that duality or dichotomy, however you want to call it, is this, that we live in an overly expressive era. We live in an era where every emotion has to be talked out, every experience has to be written out, every trip has to be posted on social media. The concept of being sacred is losing its effect nowadays. And in the process now, we believe that the honor and respect that I deserve, I won't get unless I announce everything that I've done or everything that I've accomplished. When you look at the world of the corporations and corporate Canada, it's a reality that unless you make yourself visible and you announce what you've been doing, and you report to your boss, and you show them your product, and you show them your work, you won't get your promotion. In the academic world, you have to sit there and constantly tell everybody your credentials, what you've accomplished, the degrees you hold, if you're published or not, how many years have you been in this industry. All of that is for you now to somehow have some form of respect in the world of academia or education. And those things exist, don't get me wrong. It's a reality of society. The problem is that when people like me believe that that's how the deen should be as well. And it's the complete opposite. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, time and time again, through various ayat of the Quran, and we'll share some of them across the 5 nights, is telling us something else. He's telling us that as much as you can, hide your good deeds. The same way that we hide our deficiencies, our defects, the same way that we hide our sins and our mistakes from others, we also should be hiding our deficiencies as well, our sins as well, and hiding our good deeds as well, actually. The verse that I have the sharaf of reciting from the khutbah, that's not quite on my tongue just yet, but it'll get there by tomorrow, is from Surah Baqarah, verse number 271. And my amazing AV guys, if I can ask you to please put that up on the screen, let's dissect this verse a little bit and find out what exactly is it that I want to accomplish across these 5 nights. Sallu ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad, please. The first is actually a continuation of 3 or 4 or 5 verses in Surah Baqarah around the late 260s, early 270s, where Allah talks about the beauty of giving, the beauty of charity, the idea of sadaqat. In this month, of course, whenever and however you can, give. There are incredible organizations out there who really are working very hard to ensure that everybody has the right to have an iftar, everybody has a bite to eat in this month. If you can, with your children, make it a family effort to choose your charity and choose your campaign and go online or whatever the process is, and show your children a part of the Ramadan experience is for us to think about others. Khair. In these verses, Allah talks about that. He says it's one thing to give your sadaqat openly. That's okay, there's goodness in that. There's no problem in that. And we'll talk a little bit about the idea that some good deeds should be made open, should be made zahir. We'll talk about that a little bit later on in a few days. But then he says that in tukhfuha wa tu'tuha al-fuqara, if you hide it and you give it, that va, that the wa you see on the screen is why wasliya, yani it combines both them together. Tukhfuha wa tu'tuha. In the state of it being concealed, you give it. Give it to who? To the faqir, to the one who's in need. فَهُوَ خَيْرٌ لَكُمْ. That's actually better for you. Better than what? Better than openly announcing that you're giving this sadaqah to somebody. The first one is not a bad deed at all. We're trying to reach a level where we perfect our deeds. We reach the kamal of our a'mal. Allah says if you conceal it, if you hide it, and don't announce it, and you give it in the state of being concealed, it's better for you. To the point where the results of that is what? That not only will it be something that is filled with rewards, but actually وَيُكَفِّرُ عَنْكُمْ مِنْ سَيَّآتِكُمْ. A portion of your سَيَّآت, of your sins, will be pardoned, will be moved, will be covered. كَفَرَ, يعني to cover something. And then the beautiful part that I'll expand on a little bit later on is the last portion of this verse. Allah reminds us. He reminds, وَاللَّهُ بِمَا تَعْمَلُونَ خَبِيرٌ. Allah is fully aware of what you do. Now sometimes that's taken as a negative. Allah sees the sins that we do behind closed doors. It's not always negative. Allah sees the good deeds that we do also behind closed doors. There are right now people online listening to me, mothers with young children, who are either nursing, or the kids are asleep, or the kids can't make it, and they're quietly sacrificing, listening to a lecture online. There are those who can't fast, who are ill, watching online. There are those who have social anxiety, who can't leave their home, watching online. There are those who are newly divorced, God forbid, and out of sheer shame and fear of people's judgment, they're at home watching. There's a million groups out there right now watching me online. And Allah sees that sacrifice. Now, sometimes I tell you, and I've talked about this on Thursday nights here with all of you, that sometimes it feels like in a world where everything has to be expressed, in a world of glamorization, where if you go to the gym, or you walk on the beach with your spouse, or you have an apple for a snack, the whole world has to know about it. In that overly expressive era, there are some people who quietly do their work, quietly do their amal, either because they're forced to or because they choose to. But sometimes it's got to be the question that, does anyone see my sacrifice? Does anybody see what I'm doing? Because sometimes the people close to them don't give them the validation that they require. And that's why sometimes we have this disease of announcing every big or small act of goodness that we do, right? There are people who have mastered this, I tell you. Somehow in the conversation, they'll squeeze in some act they did 10 years ago, some great act they did 5 years ago. Aslan, there's no rap, there's no marbut, nothing. We're talking about A, they bring up B. Just to pause the conversation, to tell people like me or others how great they are and how much they've done. And they actually believe if I don't say that, the amal will get lost. The deed will go unnoticed. And that's why one thing that we'll expand on in these next 5 nights is the connection between this topic of being anonymous and the first sifat in Surah Baqarah of the muttaqeen, alladhina yu'minuna bil ghaib. There are those who believe in the unseen. By us constantly professing and announcing our good deeds to the whole world, hashtag this and Instagram post this, we're telling God indirectly now that, look, I believe in you, I just don't think that you can look after my respect and my izzat. So let me take that in my own hands. Let me make sure everyone knows how great I am and respect me in the process. When in reality, the last portion of the verse says that Allah is fully aware. And once Allah is fully aware, He will make sure that it's known to others as well. Sallu ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. So that's what we're trying to achieve in the next 5 nights. We'll look at why. Why do some people feel the need to tell everybody everything about themselves? Why is there a desire, an addiction almost, that if someone does a good act where nobody sees it, there's this itch inside of them, this addiction inside of them, this voice inside of them, tell one person, tell 10 people, tell 100 people. What is that about? Why is there a emptiness inside of me that I need to be filled with praise of people? What's missing inside of me? Why can't I just drop it in the ocean of Allah where I know and Allah knows and move on with my life? Some people can't do it. And this affects all of us. I'm not immune to this. Because really, let's be honest, we like a little bit of the talia, right? We like the shabash. We like the pat on the back, the plaque, and the awards day. We like the walk up the stage. We like the shaking of the hands. All that ujb inside of us, the self-love we have inside of us, that self-conceit inside of us, wants to be fed sometimes. It feels good to be noticed, acknowledged. And that's fine, but leave that to God. We don't need to take our own respect into our own hands. Because no matter how hard we try, we'll never reach that level. When God decides to spread our name with praise amongst the family, amongst the community, nothing we do can ever compare to that praise. The hadith of the Holy Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Allahumma salli ala. He says the highest reward belongs to the most secretive act. You come here in the daytime, let's say for example, you find the masjid to be a little bit dirty, let's say, a few crumbs here and there, you think, okay, it's a program tonight, there's a vacuum lying there, let me quickly sort of plug it in, quickly vacuum, right? Nobody sees me, I go, I vacuum the masjid, it's spotless, nobody sees me, I put the vacuum exactly where it is, and I drive away and I feel great about myself, it's a good act, mashallah. You should feel good about yourself. And then you come in the evening and you sit in the mosque and the marks of the vacuum, you know those marks? They're still there. And people are saying, wow, bhai, kya vacuum kiya lo? Yeah. It's amazing, so clean. I wonder who did it. They outdid themselves. And you're smiling and you're grinning and now you're itchy a little bit. Right? Kujli adi zara sa, itchy. You're dying to tell somebody, it was me. Remember, so far, you and God, right? Maybe the live stream was on, who knows, but you and God. That's it. Knew that you vacuumed the masjid. Now you come and this narcissistic dimension inside of us takes over. And we tell one person. It felt good. We tell one person, the guy beside me. You know what? It was actually me. I was here in the area, didn't want to say anything, but I thought, you know what? This and that. And the person was, oh my goodness, you did an amazing job. What a great act, right? If only I had that kind of time, you should feel, you know, you're so blessed, blah, blah, blah. Allah accepted, and that feels good. Now you tell yourself, that's one person. Imagine 10 people knowing. And before we know it, someone like me, an act that had written inside of me, a good act, worthy of praise and punishment, worthy of praise and reward, is now an act for my ego and my ghurur. Well, now whoever has two ears, I want to tell them that was my vacuum marks on the carpet. It's a silly example, but it's a fight that all of us have. Whereas Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, bury them. Bury your good deeds. I will then raise them up, and I'll present to you a hadith throughout the week to tell you the fact that let's not take the izzah into our own hands. Let's make sure we let Allah do it. Sallu ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. Now, where does this come from? You know, nowadays we have buzzwords, right? Everything has a cute little word attached to it. There's a buzzword nowadays called virtue signaling. Virtue signaling. One of my pet peeves when I drive my car is that if the guy in front of me is turning right, he doesn't signal. I want to honk the horn and tell him next time signal, but I'm afraid it's one of you guys driving, so I'm quiet. It happened once before, true story. I said, Mulana Abba, I said, yeah, sorry about that. I don't mind my anger. It's Ramadan, I'm hungry. So I don't say a word, I keep it within myself. But that's my pet peeve. That no one signals when they're driving. The signal, the right signal, the left signal, tick, 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 tick. That tells me, and that tells person beside me, behind me, in front of me, in my car, that I'm turning right. So I signal. I tell the whole world around me that I'm turning right, and you adjust accordingly. That's called signaling. We have something called virtue signaling. We turn on our virtue blinkers and tell the person in front of me, behind me, beside me, inside of me, all the virtues I've done. Maybe in an attempt, like I said, to feed that ego. Now, why did I choose this topic in this month of Ramadan? I'll explain that as well. We all know that it's very, very ajeeb. This month of Allah is, no matter how you look at it, there are so many benefits to this month, it's quite incredible. In the last Jummah khutbah of Sha'ban, and majority of the imams of Jummah recite this khutbah, the last khutbah, last Jummah of Sha'ban, when the Holy Prophet introduces this month to all of us. Okay? About halfway through the month, do me a favor and revisit that khutbah. Where he says, you know, the days of this month are unlike any other days, the nights are unlike any other nights. And then he says, أَنْفَاسِكُمْ فِيهِ تَصْبِيحٍ وَنَوْمُكُمْ فِيهِ عِبَادَةٍ. Your breathing is the tasbih of Allah. Your sleep is the ibadat of Allah. In this month, دُعِيتُكُمْ فِيهِ إِضَافَةُ اللَّهِ. In this month, you have been what? You have been invited as the guest of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now, the interesting part is when you look at the verse in Surah Baqarah that talks about the wujub and the obligation of fasting, it does not mention any other group but the mu'mineen. In Surah Baqarah, it says, Ya ayyuhal ladhina amanu, Kutiba alaykum as-siyam, correct? كَمَا كُتِبَ عَلَى الَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِكُمْ لَعَلَّكُمْ تَتَّقُونَ All you who believe, the mu'mineen, all of you, alhamdulillah. Fasting is prescribed for you, written for you, wajib for you, obligation for you, just like it was for those before you. لَعَلَّكُمْ تَتَّقُونَ So you could reach a level of piety. Now, what piety does God want? And how is this marbut with my topic? Let's discuss that very quickly. صَلُّوا عَلَى مُحَمَّدْ وَعَلَى مُحَمَّدْ, please. So I'll tell you what the narrative is that bothers me about virtue signaling. The narrative is that it is inevitable, Syed, in this day and age, we have to do this. We have to announce everything that we do. Okay? Otherwise, we'll get nowhere in life. My family won't respect me. I won't get my promotion. I won't get my credits. I won't get my job, blah, blah, blah. It is inevitable. We have to sort of give into the culture that we're living in today. I don't buy that sometimes. I'll tell you why. Because this wajib act of fasting is very specific to all of you. Other acts of worship aren't like that. For example, in Hajj, Surah Hajj talks about the idea and telling Nabi Ibrahim, وَأَذِّن فِي النَّاسِ بِالْحَجِّ وَأَذِّن أَذِّن يَنِي أَذَان Call people. Proclaim who? فِي النَّاسِ All of mankind. Everybody. Towards what? بِالْحَجِّ Towards Hajj. Meaning, the idea is that call them towards my baits. And you see on the screen, يَعْتُكَ الرِّجَالُ عَلَى كُلِّ ضَامِرِ And they'll come on foot, all the men, they'll come one by one from every corner, blah, blah, blah. But the muhatib, the audience is finnasi, mankind, everybody, right? The verse when it comes to the fasting is not يَا أَيُّهَا النَّاسِ يَا بَنِي آدَمَ كُتِبَ عَلَيْكُمُ السِّيَامِ It's يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا It's the mu'mineen, it's the believers. Why fasting of all acts of worship? Remember, fasting is a formless act of worship. It's a shapeless act of worship. It's a faceless act of worship. When someone prays salat, you know they're praying salat. There's ruku, there's sujood, there's bowing, there's standing, there's getting up, there's qunut. You could tell there's a shape to it. Someone's doing hajj, they're doing tawaf, they're doing sa'i. Right? They're throwing rocks, they're shaving their head, they're sacrificing animals. There's a whole form to Hajj. Even when you give khums, there is a whole transaction. You give the khums, you get the receipt. Amr bil Ma'ruf is also done through a conversation. But fasting is not like that. One of the very few acts of worship doesn't have a form to it. If somebody walks in fact, I don't know how many of you today fasted. I have no idea. No one wears buttons saying, I'm fasting today. No one has a sign that I'm fasting today. No one walks in saying, Salam, I'm fasting. How are you? I'm fasting. Hey, I'm fasting. No one does that. In fact, the ulama have said that as much as you can when it comes to fasting, very ajib, as much as you can, mustahab wajib fast, hide the fast. Hide the fast. Someone comes, offers you a glass of water on a mustahab fast. Right? And you know the hukum is you can open the fast. So really you're praying, please, Yad. Somebody give me a glass of water. Right? So they bring you the water. Even at that moment, the ulama say, no, you know what? I'm not thirsty. Have a bite. I'm okay. I'm full. I'm not feeling the best. Hide the fact that you're fasting. When there's a lot of sort of israr and please, 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 then have a little bit. But the idea to jump, oh no, I can't, I'm fasting. Whoa, 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 calm down. Calm down. It's a very internal batini act of worship fasting. And that's precisely what Allah wants to train you. You can fast all day. And by the way, all of you know, you have to constantly be in the state of fasting all day long. I don't mean just hungry and thirsty. I mean your niyyah and intention has to always be there to fast. The moment you break that intention and you hop in your car and you drive down to Tim Hortons, I'm gonna break my fast, I'm starving with a donut and a coffee, I get to the drive-thru long, it's too long, I turn around, it's okay, 3 hours, I'll wait, no problem, your fast is gone. It's been broken. It's one thing where you think, I can't wait, I'm gonna have kukupaka tonight, that's one thing. doesn't break your fast. I did that 3 times today. But driving in your car, starting your car, making a left, getting to your Tim Hortons, waiting in line, then saying, you know what, it's too long, forget it. At that moment, you've broken your intention to fast. Now you're no longer fasting. Which means what? Allah says, not only is it wajib on you, while you're fasting, to be constantly in a very esoteric batini, internal, hidden act of worship. And you are going throughout your day. The kids are in school. The men and women are at work. Everyone's doing whatever they can. A little bit of adjustment in napping. You might take a nap at lunchtime, whatever the case may be, but your day doesn't stop. It's possible, God says, for you to worship without anybody knowing it. It's possible to spend, what, 18 hours, 10 hours fasting without announcing it to the world. In fact, if someone told me, hey, I'm fasting, that's quite odd. I didn't ask. I don't really want to know. Between you and God. And the fact that he's asking the believers to do it is telling you and I, the believers can do it. You can do greatness without telling the world. So let's not buy this narrative. It's inevitable. We live in a social media world. What am I supposed to post? I'm trying to support and encourage people. There's other ways to do that. Not by constantly promoting yourself. Why promote yourself when you have God to promote you? Let him do that job. Sallu ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad, please. Now the question is, why do people virtue signal? What's inside of them that's lacking? We'll expand on that as well throughout the first 4 or 5 nights to make sure that we understand, are we one of those people? Because the problem is that when you become a person like that, it's an addiction for some people. They like the sound of their own voice, right? Silence inside of our voice, silence inside of our deeds. It's a lost art. There are some people that the more they talk, the less you listen. It's like that. And there are some, the moment they open their mouth, all ears are attached to what they're saying. Look at the Holy Prophet, beautiful hadith. A man approaches him and says, Ya Rasulullah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, please. My last point is the masadua. He says, Ma'al ilm, beautiful hadith, one of my favorites. What is knowledge? Qalu insat, he says. Knowledge is silence. Thumma ma, what else is knowledge? Qalu istima', he says. Listening very carefully is knowledge. Then what? Thumma ma? Qalu al-hifz. Retain what you've heard. Knowledge in levels in order. Thumma ma, he says, the fourth ingredient. Now what's knowledge? He says, once you have been silent, and once you have listened carefully, and once you have retained, then the fourth step is amalu bih. Act on what you've retained. And then he says, thumma ma. Now what is knowledge? Then he says, al-nashr. Then you spread what you already acted upon. What a beautiful hadith. Where is spreading? Number 5. After what? Silence, listening, retention. Those 3 are quiet acts. Those 3 are batini, internal acts. People like me spread before I even know what I'm spreading. I humbly ask you, it's a simple request. I'm sorry for my simple requests. Those who are WhatsApp happy, those who love to forward everything, please be very careful. The Prophet is saying, understand what you're forwarding. Now it says, forwarded many times when it gets to my phone. That means it's already been through the circle, mashallah. And usually people don't forward happy things, they forward controversial things. A clip from an alim, 30 seconds, look what he said about juluses, or about alams, or about nazar, or about matam, or about the marja, or about this. 30 seconds of a 1-hour clip, it's floating around. All I did, Mana, was I forwarded it. Be careful. If it can stop at you, let it stop at you. Like, I know literally when I see a name on my phone, I know the video, I don't want to watch it. I don't want to watch it. There would be ashab of the Holy Prophet that would come to the Prophet and begin to talk ill of another sahabi, and the Prophet would stop him and say, listen, that so-and-so companion, I have a very good reputation of him in my mind. I love him. He's very close to me. I adore him. I respect him. I don't want your words to taint that respect of mine. So keep it within yourself. Silence is a lost art. But silence is the pathway towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In an overly expressive era, to be quiet with our tongue and quiet with our good deeds is a challenge. And that's what I mean by being anonymous. Let God take care of the vacuum streaks on the carpet. He'll do it. Eventually he'll do it. I'll show you how this that will blow you away. It's a promise of God. So inshallah, from tomorrow, we'll talk about the psychology of it. Why are some of us like this? What's missing inside that we need to fill this up with the praise of others, inshallah. But that is from tomorrow. We ask you, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to accept our ibadat in the month of Ramadan, inshallah. We ask you, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to forgive our sins and those of our parents, to elevate our a'mal and to ready us for the nights of Qadr. And finally, Allah, we ask you that everything we do in the month of Ramadan is to get close to you and also to prepare for the arrival of our Imam. Thank you very much. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.